Good morning. Would you pray with me, please? Awaken our ears, O God. Open our minds that we might recognize your voice and discover your wisdom. Guide our thoughts that we might adopt Christ's attitude of humility and love. Strengthen our resolve that we might walk with you to the end, even if it means death on a cross. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Please stand as we sing our hymn of praise, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna, number 278 in the United Methodist Hymnal.
Would you join with me in reciting the Apostles' Creed, which is on the screen and also in your bulletin? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The scripture lesson for this morning comes from Deuteronomy, Chapter 11, 18 through 28. You shall put these words of mine in your heart and soul, and you shall bind them as a sign of your hand. and fix them as an emblem on your forehead. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates, also that your days and the days of your children may be multiplied in the land that the Lord swore to your ancestors to give them, as long as the heavens are above the earth. If you will diligently observe this entire commandment and that I am commanding you, loving the Lord your God, walking in all his ways and holding fast to him, then the Lord will drive out all these nations before you, and you will dispossess nations larger and mightier than yourselves. Every place on which you set foot shall be yours. Your territory shall extend from the wilderness to the Lebanon, and from the river Euphrates, to the western sea. No one will be able to stand against you. The Lord your God will put the fear and the dread of you on all the land on which you set foot, as he promised you. See, I am setting before you today a blessing and a curse. The blessing, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, and the curse, if you do not obey the commandments of the Lord your God, but turn from the way that I am commanding you today and follow other gods that you have not known. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I invite you into a personal time of silent prayer. Eternal God, we give you thanks this beautiful Palm Sunday where we can gather and remember the triumphal entry of your Son, our Savior, Jesus the Christ, when he came into Jerusalem to face the last week of his earthly life. We remember with celebration, but we also remember because we know what is to come. We remember with trepidation, with a little bit of sadness, and lots of humility. For what Jesus did was meant to be an example for all of us, to put the lives of others above our own. And too often we are seeking only to exalt ourselves. Help us, O God, to be followers of your Son, true followers, who will listen to the words that he taught us, so that we will indeed stand on the solid rock of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us, O God, to obey his commands. Give us the strength and the courage to follow, even when the direction he leads us seems so different from the direction the world is telling us to go. Give us strength and courage. We live in a world that is filled with violence and bloodshed and war. And we are taken aback when we see images of people being killed ruthlessly. And we just pray for guidance for those in our government who make difficult decisions. We pray for your leading. We pray for your humility, that none of the decisions they make are taken lightly. Help us to be people of peace as we follow the Prince of Peace. And help us to know how to live that out in a world where there is so much violence. We pray these things, O God, in the name of our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of preparation is My Hope is Built, number 368 in the United Methodist Hymnal.
Trust the sweetest frame, Lord, holy lead on.
Heavenly Father, help us to be generous givers, both of our money and our lives. Let us use these offerings for the benefit of all those in need. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 7, verses 24 through 27. Everyone, then, who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. The rain fell, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell, and great was its fall. May God bless the reading of his word. There was a couple, the man was worried about his wife because it seemed like her hearing was not what it used to be. She wasn't hearing things as well, and he kept telling her to go to the doctor, and she would refuse to go. Well, finally, he had a doctor's appointment. He went and told about his wife that she couldn't hear anymore, but she would not go to the doctor. And he said, well, this is what I want you to do. I want you to do this little test. Now, when you're in the house, ask her a question, and when she doesn't answer, walk closer to her and ask the same question again. And if she doesn't answer, walk closer to her and then ask the same question again. And so he said, okay, I'll try that, just to see how bad her hearing is. And so he went home, and that evening his wife was in the kitchen making dinner, and he said, honey, what's for dinner? He didn't hear a thing.
So I went closer, and he said, "Honey, what's for dinner?" Still nothing. So finally he went right behind her and he said, quite loudly, "Honey, what's for dinner?" And she turned around and said, "For the third time, I said fried chicken." Okay, today we are on our final sermon in our series on the Sermon on the Mount, based on a book called Christ of the Mount by a man named E. Stanley Jones, who is if you haven't heard of him, he was a great missionary to India. He was called the Apostle of Peace. He was proclaimed to be the best missionary since St. Paul. He was on the cover of Time magazine. He was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. He won the Gandhi Peace Prize, but he's largely been forgotten in the last 50 years since his death. But I think his work has been very influential to me, and I'm probably going to do my doctoral thesis on him, so y'all get to listen to a lot of E. Stanley Jones in the next 2 years. So anyway, I hope you don't get sick of him. But anyway, this is based on his book on the Sermon on the Mount, and I talked earlier about some of the things that we had discussed, from we need to be perfect, and then why we're not perfect, and the offer of God, the Holy Spirit, that helps us, gives us the power to become perfect. And then and I'm not going to go through the whole list. I've already humiliated myself by not remembering last week's sermon. But today we're talking about the solid rock. And in his book, Jones talks about, he pretty much goes back to the first chapter of the sermon, on the chapter 5. Our first week in this series was the entire chapter 5 of the book of Matthew, which is quite long. And there's all these different things in here. And Jones, what he does is say, well, this is, we just sang that song, "On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is shifting sand." Well here Jesus in here is saying, it's not just belief in me, basically. We like to think that that it's only about a head belief, and if I proclaim Jesus Christ as my Savior, that's all it takes. But he's really saying that it's about living the life he really commands us to live. It's doing the things that he says that really allows us to experience the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not just something we will enter into when we die. It's something we experience when we do what Jesus says to do, and when we are when we allow the Spirit to create us into the people that God created us to be. So he goes back, and Jones in his book goes back to chapter 5, the first chapter in the Sermon on the Mount, and starts saying, this is why you do this and you'll realize that you are on the solid rock. If you're not, you're on the shifting sand. And we go back to the first of the Beatitudes. There's actually, if you remember, Jones divided the Beatitudes into sets of three. I think it works best, two sets of three and then one set of two. But if you go to the next slide, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And the next, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Now Jones did these little triplicate things, where the first one, blessed are the poor in spirit, that he was very influenced by his life in India, the Eastern religions, where they talk about detachment. And detachment from material things. And Jones thought that was really what Jesus was saying here. Blessed are the poor in spirit. It's an attitude of being poor. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have no money or no possessions, but your attitude is a really healthy attitude towards the possessions that you have. You own your possessions, they don't own you. There's a detachment there. Too often in our world, we are really attached to our possessions. Our possessions define us. The size of our house defines us. The kind of car we drive defines us. Or what? All these different external trappings that we have we let that define us, and we find our identity in those things instead of our identity in Christ. But if we have a healthy detachment from those things, then we know that those things, if we lose all those things, we're still going to be perfectly fine. Our identity will be intact. And the second one is, blessed are those who mourn. Talking about, it's a reattachment into the material world, but it's not a reattachment to our material things, it's a reattachment to people. And so we are attached to the important things in the world. We're attached to the people in the world, or the creation in the world, but not just our stuff, but the things that are worth mourning when we lose them, when we lose someone we love, when we see the environment being destroyed in one way or another. I mean, that's when we should be mourning. And it's that kind of attitude that makes us meek. Blessed are the meek. And if you have that kind of attitude where your priorities are right, that's when you stand on the solid rock. That when your identity is in your possessions, when your identity is, or when you care so much for your possessions and you lose them, what happens to you? You find yourself on shifting sand. Remember all those stories at the beginning of the Great Depression, all those people who jumped out of windows because they had lost everything they owned? They were defined by their possessions. They were living their lives on shifting sand. The next set of Beatitudes. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Now, I think that, you know, we are very good at being righteous. We are, as Christians, we pride ourselves, maybe a little too much. We're very proud of our humility, you know, and as Christians, but we pride ourselves in our righteousness, and that's why we live, we create all these rules. If you want to be a Christian, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do this, you can't do that, or you must do this, you must do this, or must do this. And so it becomes a thing about righteousness, which is good. We should be righteous people. I mean, I'm not saying we should be legalistic people, but we should be righteous people. But we should also be merciful people, because we're never going to live up to some of these rules that we create for ourselves. But we tend to give ourselves grace when we fall short of these rules, but we don't give so much grace to other people who fall short of the rules. If we have righteousness without mercy, we become legalistic. But on the other hand, if we have mercy without righteousness, we become libertines, and we think that anything goes and we can do whatever we want. It doesn't matter how we live our lives. You need that balance between righteousness and mercy, and when we do have that balance, that's when we become pure in heart. Now, I think that we, most Christians, are pretty good at the righteousness thing, and often we're good at the mercy. We might have certain areas where we're good at mercy, and other areas we're not so good at mercy. But Jesus did talk about the mercy thing. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. Don't you wish Jesus had never said this? I personally wish Jesus had never said this, maybe because I might be a little too attached to my personal possessions. I don't want to give to everybody who borrows. I don't want to live this out. This is not easy stuff. But if we're so attached to our possessions, if we don't mourn for those people who are in need, then we are back on that shifting sand. Booker T. Washington, this is a quote from Jones' book. As Booker T. Washington said, no man can keep another man down in the gutter without staying down with him. So if we don't show mercy to people who are in need, we might as well be in the gutter with them. Maybe we may not be physically in the gutter with them, but spiritually we are. Jones goes on to say, this is true economically, socially, politically, and spiritually, and vice versa. No man can lift another man from the gutter in any of these realms without rising in the process of lifting. That's how we get to the solid rock. We do what Jesus said to do. We show mercy. We are righteous, yes, but we also show mercy. It's a difficult thing because we want to draw a line. Oh, I'll be merciful up to a point. I'll give up to a point. And in reality, we have limited resources. We can't give everything. But we do have the resource of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit that empowers, that transforms, that will guide us, give us discernment. Let's move on to the next one, which I think is the one we deal with a lot lately. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. You know, well, this is Palm Sunday. We remember the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem. People waving palms, throwing their cloaks on the ground before him. It must have been quite a sight. But when you think about it, what was Jesus riding on? A donkey. Thank you. A donkey. Have you ever seen donkey basketball? That is not a very majestic way to ride into town. A donkey is, you know, they're good animals, they're dependable animals. Well, I've never owned a donkey, I don't know. I might not know a thing about these donkeys, but they've been used a long time, beasts of burden. But, Jesus riding on a donkey is not how you would want your king to ride into town. Now, on the other side of town, there's a book called Last Week, about the last week of the life of Christ, that came out a few years ago by Dominic Crossan and Marcus Borg, New Testament scholars. They said that same day, most likely, or around that time, there would have been another procession into Jerusalem. Pilate, the ruler of the area, would have come in on a great white horse. This is actually not, this is from the movie Ben-Hur, the recent remake of Ben-Hur. I found this picture, but that kind of depicts what we would think Pilate would have come in on. A white horse, looking very powerful. Look at all the soldiers on horseback behind him. Or the next picture, which is a legion of soldiers that probably would have followed him. This is the kind of king we want, isn't it? This is the kind of king we follow. We really want to have this powerful king, and yet we have a king that rode in on a donkey. We have a king that was humble, that was not after physical power, who did not use physical force. The weapon he had was love. It's not how we want to live. I mean, this week, you know, for any president who has to make decisions, I mean, I'm glad I don't have to do that. But, I mean, what Assad did to his people in Syria was abhorrent. Awful things to his people. But the thing that disturbed me was not so much that the president sent missiles over there. It was what the response to some people, his biggest critics on the left and on the right, would say things like, well, this is the time that he first seemed presidential to me. I mean, yeah, maybe he was presidential because he had to make a difficult decision, but is really warfare the time just because he made this difficult decision to bomb somebody? Is that what makes someone presidential? Didn't Jesus, well, it's not maybe presidential, but it's not Christ-like, I think. I mean, we can have this debate. It's a very, this is a difficult, difficult issue. But what is Christ-like? Jesus who rode in on a donkey? Or Pilate who rode in on a big white horse? We really want it. We want Jesus to be more like Pilate, I think. then we want him to be like Jesus. In the book of Acts, in the first chapter of the book of Acts, it says that Jesus spent the time after his resurrection, between his resurrection and his ascension, he spent his time appearing to people and talking about the kingdom of God. And then a few verses later, one of the disciples said to Jesus, "Is this the time when you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" This guy didn't get it. Jesus was talking about a heavenly kingdom on earth. And this one disciple was ready for Pilate to ride in, or Jesus on that horse instead of Pilate, to ride in on horseback and restore Israel's glory. This is a difficult issue. Sometimes I wish I hadn't brought it up. But anyway, the next slide was this is a quote from Jones in his book. "The method of getting rid of your enemies by loving them, how unsubstantial it seems alongside the quick, solid way of getting rid of them by force. But the method of force turns out to be the great illusion. For if you conquer the body of a man, you do not touch the real man. Only love and goodwill are strong enough to reach down to the inner life and turn one from enmity to goodwill." I won't go to this slide yet, but I'm thinking about, you know, World War II, the end of World War II, and how the Allies treated the people that had started the wars against us. The Marshall Plan, the rebuilding of Germany, the rebuilding of Japan. Now, we could have done what the Soviet Union did and build a fence and trying to keep people in and make people rule ruthlessly over these people, or we could have been like we were and loved those people that had started a war against us and showed grace and mercy to those people who started a war against us and helped rebuild their countries. And now we're allies with the Germans and the Japanese. I don't think it doesn't seem to be that black and white, but sometimes Jesus says stuff that might be black and white, but we refuse to see it as black and white. I think we never really give God the chance, because we act out of fear instead of faith. Jesus said that if you do what he says to do, we'll stand on solid rock. And yet we live most of our lives. Most of history has been lived in shifting sand, because we refuse to place our faith in the God of love, because we prefer a God of power and might. Jones ended his chapter with this: "The eye was made for light, the ear for music, the heart for love, so our very being was made for Jesus' way of life." The Jesus way of life is a life lived on solid rock. Every other way is shifting sand. This is what Jesus placed before us, and we have a choice to make. Will we continue to serve the gods that lead us to shifting sand, or will we follow the God who will allow us to stand on solid rock? Let's pray. Eternal God, you have placed before us difficult things. And you have shown us that if we do these things, live the way you want us to live, if we follow you, that we will find ourselves on solid rock. But sometimes, God, we are more comfortable in shifting sand because we feel like we have more control. Help us, oh God, to follow you. Give us clarity as we read your word so that we can know what your word really means and how we can live it out in this world. Help us to be people of peace. Help us to be people of grace and mercy. And we do pray for those who make the decisions, the difficult decisions. That take our country into dangerous directions. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.